moving in our midst. I worship you. I worship you. You are here working in this place. Yeah. And I worship you. God, I worship you. Let's sing. You are here moving in our midst.
Moving in our midst.
And he's moving right where you are. I worship you. You were created to. I worship you.
You are here.
Working in this place.
Working in this
in our hearts. That's where you're doing the work, God.
I worship you.
Worship you.
I worship you.
So we love to call you Waymaker.
Waymaker. Miracle worker. Promise keeper. Light in the darkness. My God. Darkness, my God, that is who you are.
You are here, you are here, touching every heart,
touching every heart.
We pray for those watching.
I worship you.
That he would touch your heart right where you are.
I worship
you. You are here.
You are here.
You're healing every heart.
Healing every heart.
Some people need a touch from you, God.
I worship
you. Heal the brokenhearted, yeah.
I worship you.
You are here.
You are here.
You're mending every heart.
Mending every
you put some
heart.
Things back together for us.
I worship
we
you.
Worship you, oh God.
I worship
and you are here.
You are here.
Turning lives around.
Turning lives around.
Some people didn't know that they were gonna know this year. And so we thank you for turning things around, God. Yeah. Waymaker,
Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper.
That is who you are. Hallelujah. Good morning, great morning, God morning. I am lay pastor Sean Saxon. Welcome to the City of Refuge United Church of Christ. We are a ministry of restoration. We are intentionally radically inclusive, welcoming all persons regardless of race, color, ancestry, age, gender, ability, sexual or affectional orientation. We celebrate the Creator's diversity. We worship Christ and welcome persons from all faith paths, which harmonize with the ministry of Jesus Christ. Reverend Dr. Yvette Flunder, presiding bishop of the Fellowship of Affirming Ministries and senior pastor of Refuge Ministries, the pastoral team, and entire congregation, thank you for worshiping with us today. If you are a first-time visitor or have not been with us for a while, please let us know by typing hashtag visitor in the chat. And refugees, please show love to our visitors and those who are returning. And now, Pastor Phil, with our prayer.
Good morning. I'm Pastor Phil Gray, and we would like to thank you for joining us this morning. It's prayer time, and because it's prayer time, I want you to put in the forefront of your mind what you want God to do. This has been a strange week for all of us. Our prayer list today is extensive because so many of our brothers and sisters are going through something. We want to lift up the entire leadership of City of Refuge and our family outside of City of Refuge with the loss of our brother Leonard Connor and Pastor Janet Somerville. We want to lift up Sean Nutley, and we want to lift up and pray for him as he practices financial discipline and he's being prepared to move to a different career. And we pray for strength in the school. We're praying for Jerry, and we're praying for Carol Robinson. We're praying for Minister Ramon Jackson, who lost an aunt this week. We're praying for Minister Terry Wells and his family, who also lost an aunt. We're praying for our own Lucretia Durden, who lost her sister on Friday. We're praying for our Deacon Pam Mack, who is still recovering from surgery. And we're sending prayers and strength for perseverance to Dawn Jefferson and Marquita Brooks as they go through the storm that's happening in Washington, D.C. And we're praying for Ken Jones, who's back in the hospital. And we're also praying for Michael Blackbird. We also have a praise report, even though we have so many people on our prayer list. We want to pray and thank God for Tana and Dr. Katrina, who have now secured housing. So as we go into prayer, remember, put whatever your needs are and whatever what you need in the forefront of your mind and on your heart. And if you know somebody who's not on this list, put them on your heart and on your mind. And let us pray. Father God, in the name of Jesus, we come before you right now, first and foremost, to say thank you. We thank you, God, because you are still a way-making God. You have made ways out of no ways so many times in our lives. In spite of what we are going through and what our people are going through, we still know you're God, and above you there is no other. We ask, God, that you meet the needs of your people in a special way as we move forward this week. There's some decisions that have to be made in the White House and in Congress and in the representatives that represent each state. We need you to go forward and do what you do, God. Bless your people. God, you've heard the names on this list, and we're asking right now that you meet every need. Those who are in the hospital, those who are going through storms. God, we're depending on you because we know that you are an able God. You are a way-making God. You are our bridge over troubled water. You are our lawyers in the courtroom. You're our doctors in the sick room. Make it so this week, God. Meet the needs of your people. bless our congregation and bless those who are worshiping with us today. You already know what we need. You already know what our situations are. We're placing them at your feet right now in the name of Jesus. We ask that you bless our bishop and her family as they go through this next level of the storm. We ask that you build a fence of protection around her and her family. In Jesus' name we pray. We ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. And at this time, we're going to turn it over to Minister Ramon Jackson.
Good morning, family. I'm Minister Ramon Jackson, here with your giving moment. At the City of Refuge UCC, we strive daily to empower, enrich, and renew disenfranchised and marginalized communities, both locally and abroad. It is through generous donations from you, our family, friends, visitors, and viewers, local refuge programs such as the Word of Mouth Food Pantry, LGBTQ and differently abled education and inclusion work, national social justice and equality activism through TFAM, the Fellowship of Affirming Ministries, as well as our missions and ministries in Mexico, Asia, Africa, and the United Kingdom can continue to make room at the table for everyone. We invite you to become a part of our efforts in providing practical, no-harm solutions to critical community and world issues. No donation is too small to make a difference, and giving is simple. You can use text to give by texting 510-257-9001. Entering the amount that you'd like to give, pressing send, and following the prompts through EasyTithe. Or you can use PayPal at www.paypal.me/CORUCC or Cash App at $CORUCC. We thank you in advance for your gifts and partnering with us in making someone's life brighter when things aren't so bright. This week, we're giving you time to prepare yourselves for a good moment. So, as you're giving, you might want to put on some shoes with some traction, clear a safe space or path in your space. Maybe take a real good seat. Don't forget about your tissues, because we're about to go in. Yes, prepare for a moment in our Father's face. Our Bishop, Yvette Flunder, singing, "I Need Thee."
Bless your name, Jesus. Hallelujah.
I don't know about you, but I had to get myself together. Hallelujah. Bless your name. Bless your holy name, Jesus. Yes, nothing like real good church, no matter where you are. The anointing comes through no matter where you are. We thank God for Bishop. We thank God for the outpouring of his anointing. Hey, bless your name, God. Bless your name, Jesus. Bless your anointing. Bless your name, God. Bless your holy name. Woo. Bless your name, Jesus. This is Consecration Month 2021 at the City of Refuge United Church of Christ. And our theme this year is, do you have good religion? On last Sunday, Bishop Flunder posed three questions to you. And yes, we want you to answer them. There's a video thread in our Facebook page, as well as an email blast that went out that included our SurveyMonkey link for all of you to be included in the learning process. These will continue to be a part of your response methods during this month's lessons. Please be mindful of your emails and check our Facebook page to be a part of the conversation. This week's question of focus is question number one. What did you once believe that you now doubt? Here are some of last week's responses. That you have to be clean and in right standing before God would help you. That the devil exists and that hell and heaven exists. I don't have doubt, but an awareness of fragility of our humanity as we walk in Holy Spirit on a brief but important journey. A literal heaven and hell, the second coming of Christ. The idea that God is personally controlling and intervening in the details of our lives. If I pray and have enough faith, God will answer my prayers. God is always judging us and will ultimately judge our whole life as to how sin-free we live. Same-sex relationships are wrong. Men are the leaders. The virgin birth of Christ. Jesus is the only way, just to name a few. That there is heaven after death and that God is only outside of me. I not only believe, but was controlled by an apocalyptic theology, an angry deity that was consistently judging my every thought and action. I believe we are charged with creating heaven here on earth. That being a same gender loving person would condemn me to hell. That there was a prescription for getting and being saved, and unbelievers headed for hell and damnation. That I was out of God's favor as a same gender loving woman. That heaven and damnation were my due to the above and other sins. Women were less than. That God ordained the president of the United States and ours was the only righteous country. The certainty of hell. I question that certainty and that role and necessity of preaching hell to draw people into relationship with Jesus. And finally, once believed the God I knew within nature would be the same God inside the church. That so messed with my mind, it created doubt at many levels and doubt in myself. Because there was no way I could reconcile what my soul knew of God and what the experience of being woman, poor, and attempting to church from a family that was totally unchurched. It was bruising at the level of soul. Thank you so much for your honest, open, and engagement with last week's lessons. We look forward to your responses to this week's message. And now, today's scripture, a reading from 2 Timothy chapter 1, verse 7, New Revised Standard Version. For God did not give us a spirit of cowardice, but rather a spirit of power and of love and of self-discipline. May the Lord add a blessing to the reading and the hearing of his word. And now, for another week of transforming learning, have we got good religion from our wonderful, blessed, and anointed Reverend Dr. Yvette Flunder?
God bless you. Thank you very, very much, Minister Ramon. And thank you for that wonderful introduction. I feel blessed. Good to be with the family today. Not only City of Refuge here locally, but all of our kindred that are in the diaspora, the United States and outside of the United States. God bless each of you who are taking this journey with us in conversations about what is good religion and do we have it. Thank you for the courage that so many of you have had to reach down into the well, or that is your life, and bring up some of those concerns that in the past and perhaps present and maybe well into the future. Maybe the hard questions, because you are accepting and you are affirming the realities of your doubt and doing it without fear. God bless you today. I want to share some reflections with you. And I would ask the question from 2 Timothy 1:7. Have we got good religion, or do we have a love-based, fear-free life? And what is fear-based religion? And we heard it in a number of the comments that came forward. But I'd like to share a little bit of something with you that came from an elder from the Azusa Street Mission in Los Angeles, California in 1906. If you do not know that in 1906, which by the way, we call the revival that instituted the move of the Spirit, which we call oftentimes the second Pentecost, at Azusa Street under the leadership of William Joseph Seymour. And there were many people who were a part of organized religion who had some real doubt as to whether or not what was going on in that revival was really God, because it broke with many of the traditions of established Christian church during that time. Lots of signs and wonders. People falling out under the power of the Spirit. People speaking in tongues. The newspaper called it babbling. And so there was a great hue and cry from organized religion about that revival in 1906. One of the elders from the Azusa Street Mission said this: God, the Holy Spirit, is able to control and protect this work. If any strange manifestations come, trust the Holy Spirit, keep in prayer, and you will close the door on the enemy and show the victory won. God can use any member of the body and often gives the most abundant honor to the weaker members. This was in response, by the way, to the criticisms of staid and organized religion during that time. I also want to lift up a word from another great prophet, the Dr. Mercy Amba Odioye. In her book, Hearing and Knowing, published in 1996, when people were doubting that the Nigerian churches, which coupled their understandings of Christianity with African indigenous faith, they were very concerned as to whether or not they had received the whole counsel of God, the whole word of God. Because the way that it emerged from Nigeria, it carried with it those things that were a part of those indigenous realities. And she said it in one line. She said, the owner of the church will purify and use it. Such a powerful statement. Not too long ago, during the earlier years of the Fellowship of Affirming Ministries, we picked up a line from what was a Broadway show. And it said, there is no map for where we are going, but we are not lost, for we are here. There is no map for where we are going, but we are not lost, for we are here. God has laid the foundations for the gifts to come forth. And in this passage in 2 Timothy, the foundation for the gifts to come forth begins with moving beyond fear. And it comes through the power of love and a sound mind. God has not given us a spirit of fear, but God has given us power and love and a sound mind. And why would I see that as foundational? Because first of all, God can do whatever God wants to do through whomever God wants to do it, in whatever God ways that God chooses to do it. God did not give us a spirit of fear. And one of the reasons why we have to be free from fear is because God may well move us in directions that are unprecedented. Essentially, the young church was receiving revelatory messages from God that were inconsistent with what was the staid and true and tried way of life for those religious persons around them. And they were challenged, much the same as the Azusa Street Mission was challenged, much the same as the church in Nigeria was challenged, much the same perhaps as your faith has been challenged. Because in the hearing of the responses to question one, there have been some issues of doubt in our spirits for a long time, pushing back against what have been the staid and true and tried beliefs that we grew up around, that we have in some ways almost organically received. But God has laid a foundation for these fresh gifts and fresh revelations to come through. God has not given us a spirit of fear, but of power and of love and of a sound mind. Let me go a little further. Let's start with what God did not give us. God did not give us cowardice. Fear is torment, and it paralyzes the gift of God by waving the specter of failure over us. Fear that makes us competitive and stifles our ability to have a generous and open spirit. Fear and faith, by the way, cannot abide in the same place at the same time. If I have doubt, someone is asking, will I be appreciated? Will I be accepted? Will I be considered as good as other people? This is why we must change our motivation when we are following God. Paul told the saints, when they were freshly hearing the gospel, in all that you do, do it as unto the Lord. You focus less on failure when you offer yourself to God. Jesus ministered to the people and ministered to God, and then the leaders, and then the people and the leaders together got together and ministered to one another. Essentially, it was a beautiful circle dance that was perhaps unprecedented because what Jesus was preaching was new and fresh. God has laid the foundation for the gifts to come forth by being the one who gives first. Let me say that again. God has laid the foundation for our gifts to come forth by being the one who gives first. And what is the gift that our God has given us? It is not the spirit of fear. God has not given us a spirit of fear. God has given us power, love, and self-discipline. God has given us courage, sensitivity, and good sense. God has given us strength and charity and sobriety. God has not given us a spirit of fear, but God has given unto us the spirit of power, love, and a sound mind. Hallelujah. Power, courage, and strength alone can be devastating. It can be selfish, it can be controlling, and it can be destructive. We've seen that at the nation's capital in the last few days. Love and sensitivity and charity can sometimes be so sentimental that it is codependent and misunderstood and misdirected. And even self-discipline, what we call good sense and sobriety, can sometimes be self-righteous and haughty, overly academic and analytical. But working together, listen, these gifts are the anointing that God gives us to take our place in doing the work of God in the earth. God has not given us a spirit of fear, but of love and of power and of a sound mind. Love, self-discipline, and good sense. And I challenge you today to lay hands on your own self and speak into your own spirit that God has not given me a spirit of fear. Hallelujah. But love, power, and a sound mind. There's nothing wrong with me. I have been constructed emotionally and spiritually by the loving and direct hand of God. Power, love, and a sound mind will be our companions as we venture into what I call the three T's. Now get ready. The three T's. Theophany, all of my seminarians, you know this. The theophany, the three T's, theophany. What is theophany? The manifestation of God's presence all around us in the worship, in the songs that we've heard just today. We felt the manifestation of God's presence. Theophany, surrounded by God's presence, all in the room where you are now, all in your prayer life, all in your experience, even in struggle, the presence of God. What a blessing. Theophany, theophany. But we also have to deal with what we call theodicy. 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 Theodicy asks these questions. How does a perfectly good and powerful God permit evil? And sometimes our theophany will not permit our theodicy. I hope you hear me. There are times that our theophany dismisses our theodicy as doubt.
Bishop, we're not online.
What happened to us?
Not sure.
It's showing we're online, but it's just
we're on.
I hear it on Facebook.
Go ahead and continue, Bishop.
There are times when our theodicy hinders our theophany. I hope that you hear my heart today. But don't worry about it, because there are things that God does that may seem to us, or that God permits, that may seem to us as contrary to what we know of the heart of God. I trust that you hear me. But knowing the heart of God does not negate the fact that there are things that can happen that our perfectly good and powerful God does permit. That should not cause us in some way to move away from what we know of the nature of God. But we have to admit that we wonder, where is God in the last few days? Yes. I have asked this question again and again. Where is God? And I know that the enemy of the work that we are doing or what we are teaching does not even like us online right now. But we're going to say it anyway. There are questions, hard questions. Where is God? And I can also say to you that there are times along the way that I don't even know where the answers are to these hard questions. But I do know that the nature of God and the way of God and the manifestation of God will cause us to triumph in the end. I need to say that. But that does not mean that I don't have an opportunity to wrestle with the real and difficult theodicies. And finally, the third T, theology, which is, by the way, the systematic study of the nature of God and religion. When we study theology, what theology, when it tends to do, when it is studied historically, is move us away from the ways in which religion can embrace ideas and thoughts that are more cultural than they are theological. One of the reasons that I encourage theological education is because a systematic study will really, really, really help us to fully understand that some things are cultural, other things are systematic study of the nature of God and religion. And why is that so important, Bishop Flunder? It is important because I have seen people with incredible educational experience and background who, when they get connected to religion, will believe something simply because somebody said it, or because for three generations something has been said. And surely, if it's someone that we trust, and especially if they've been dead a long time, sometimes that will sanctify bad religion, because we are often dealing with cultural theology. We need the power, love, and sound mind that God, through Jesus and through the Apostle Paul, ministered to the church in order to deal with the three T's, with the theophanies, with the theodicies, with the theology, to be able to ground ourselves. Because there are many things coming, beloved. There are many experiences that are going to bring up for us the hard questions. And I want to release you from being afraid to ask the hard questions and to wonder about the hard and complicated difficulties. And this week, before I leave you, I also want to leave you with question four. I want you to hear question four, and I trust that you are still able to hear us, because question four is vitally important. Before I offer question four, I want to encourage you also to be a part of a gathering that we call chat, community having a table talk, and you'll find it, all of the connections to that experience at the City of Refuge website. We're going to gather together with our own congregation and folks from multiple congregations and people who are not a part of congregations. And we're going to share together to talk some about where we are and where the world is in relationship to good religion. So question four, what would be the hardest question you have for God if you were not afraid or concerned to ask it? Let me say again, what would be the hardest question that you have for God if you were not afraid or concerned to ask it? If you were not afraid or concerned to ask it. I encourage you, and I trust that I am directing you to the right place for our connection together with chat this month. And I pray that you will continue to have the important questions come forward for you. I want to say one last thing. In the book that we are reading, Brian McLaren's book, he says, and this is the quote that I want to leave. Looking back, I now see that underneath arguments about what I believe to be truly factual, something deeper and truer is happening actually. For example, whether or not the creation story happened factually as described in Genesis, I was committing myself to live in a world as if it were actually as precious and beautiful and as meaningful a creation, and as if I were too. Or whether or not a factual tree in a factual garden in a factual talking snake, I was committing myself to actually live in a world aware that I have good and just limits that I should not exceed, no matter how tempting the fruit of power, pleasure, and profit and pride were. Or whether or not the Exodus story actually happened in spirit, in history, I was committed to live in a world as if I and all my fellow humans were actually on a journey from oppression to liberation. Or whether or not Jesus was factually born of a literal virgin, or walked on literal water, or multiplied literal bread, I was committing myself to live in a world as if what seemed to be humanly possible may actually become possible if we dare to live generously against all odds. What matters most is not what happened literally, or what was written about literally, but that we get the message, hallelujah, in what it is that God is delivering to us in this time. When we get the message, when we get the message of what God is delivering us in this time, then we will have grasped the real meaning of the word of God, hallelujah. The manifestation of the word of God can never be outdated and dismissed and become obsolete when we get the message and we are not stuck on the minutia. I hope you hear me today. I hope you hear and understand God did not give you a spirit of fear, but of power and of love and good sense, a sound mind. My prayer is with you today. Keep us lifted up. God bless you.
Bishop, thank you so much for that amazing message. Gives us something to think about as we move through this year. My name is Seminarian Shannon Kearse High, and I am here to give you your announcements today. So the first announcement that I would like to speak of is we have a new baby in our church family. Miss Major and partner Beck Witt brought to life this beautiful baby, Isaiah Wittenstein Major, born at 12:58 a.m. on Saturday, January the 9th. We've been told the baby is healthy and happy and sweet with a head of hair and weighing in at, get ready for this, 9 pounds and 8 ounces. I've seen a picture and it's all cheeks. Congratulations to Miss Major and partner Beck. Congratulations. City of Refuge UCC is collaborating with CHAT, also known as Community Having a Table Talk. We're announcing a real community discussion about faith after doubt, why your beliefs stopped working and what to do about it. An amazing book written by Brian D. McLaren. We got a lot of conversation to have, y'all. So come on out and join. It's going to be live streamed to the CHAT Facebook page. That's C-H-A-T-T. Remember the periods in between each letter. Friday, January 22nd at 6:30 p.m. Pacific Standard Time. Let's ask those important questions. The Fellowship of Affirming Ministries and City of Refuge UCC is deeply saddened to announce the passing of a beloved brother of our presiding bishop. Brother Leonard Wayne Connor went on to the great cloud of witnesses on December 22nd, 2020. Memorial services will be held on Saturday, January the 30th at 11 a.m. Pacific time, and that's 2 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. Services will broadcast on City of Refuge United Church of Christ Facebook Lives page at City of Refuge UCC. Please join us in celebrating this amazing spirit's life.
We thank you for growing with us today. We pray that you have been encouraged and transformed by our time together. If you are a first-time visitor, let us know in the comment section of your platform with hashtag visitor. Hashtag Jesus if you desire to accept a relationship with Jesus Christ, or perhaps you'd like to become a part of the City of Refuge United Church of Christ community. Hashtag home is all you need to write. A member of our welcoming team will contact you shortly via Facebook Messenger for your contact information and to move you forward. If you're watching outside of our live broadcasting time and you can't wait until next Sunday to join, just send us an email to cor.refugee@gmail.com. Welcome home. Our Bishop Flunder, Mother Miller, and the City of Refuge Ministries want to hear from you. So please send us your prayer requests, comments, or questions via Instagram at Refuge UCC, Twitter and Facebook at City of Refuge UCC. If you'd like to partner with this ministry and aid in our efforts both locally and internationally, you can use Cash App at $CORUCC, PayPal at paypal.me/CORUCC, or text to give at 510-257-9001. Don't forget to respond to Bishop Plunder's questions for this week on our Facebook page or the SurveyMonkey link that will be going out to you really soon. This week's question of reflection is, what would be the hardest question you have for God if you were not afraid or concerned to ask it? Our reading this year is Faith After Doubt by Brian D. McLaren, available on Amazon, Audible, Kindle, or wherever books are sold. Again, we thank you for worshiping with us. And we're going to leave you with some encouraging words and some encouraging gospel music. You're Going to Live by J.J. Harrison. Grace and blessings.
Inside my head, there's a dream. And I